Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the Brookfield Board of Selectmen's meeting for Tuesday, April 5th. Ask everyone to please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, everyone. I'll entertain a motion to approve the warrant for 4516 for the sum of $20,707.27.
I will make that motion.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Entertain a motion to acknowledge reports and minutes from the emergency squad for March 2016 and the personnel committee for 3/24/16.
I will make that motion.
I'll second it.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Announcements. Brookfield 10th Annual Meet the Candidates Night. The Brookfield Republican Town Committee proudly announces its 10th annual Meet the Candidates Night to be held Tuesday, April 19th, starting at 6:30 p.m. in the Brookfield Town Hall Banquet Room. The event is an open forum where anyone in attendance may ask a question of any candidate. Town elections will be held Monday, May 2nd at the Town Hall. All candidates running for public office are invited to attend. The local public access committee is seeking members. The committee is also seeking videographers to tape meetings and local events. Those interested should contact Ms. Mahoney at Local Access, LOCALACCESS, at brookfieldma.us. Mr. Wallinen, District A to Senator Ann Golby, will be holding office hours at the Brookfield Town Hall from 2 to 3 p.m. Wednesday, April 20th. All are welcome. Any other announcements? I would also like to thank, a lot of people don't go to these, but there are events that the school's holding. Our little guys at the elementary school were invited to the MICA competition down in, why would I do this? I'm going to have enough brain seize. Out towards Taunt in that area.
Keep going.
They actually won a silver this year. We're highly, highly proud of those little guys. And the program that school and Mr. Fazio puts on, Rentham, he was in Rentham.
There you go.
Puts on is absolutely amazing. So I would like to personally thank everyone involved, not only our school, but the parents that dedicated to bringing the kids out. Anybody wish to address the board this evening? Nobody? We'll move on. We have two special guests this evening. Our first agenda item is Attorney General's Abandoned Housing Initiative. They're going to present what they're proposing to assist the town of Brookfield. So I welcome Ms. Pacino and Ms. Villa from the Attorney General's office. Welcome, ladies.
Good afternoon. Evening. Good evening.
I say good morning to everyone, so I'm with you. Welcome.
Thank you.
So we've been presented from two residents in town. We've had a few discussions, and we had asked, and we thank you for coming out, taking your time to present to the town of Brookfield. Usually there's one, if not two, people in the crowd, so you guys are the draw this evening, and I turn the floor over to you.
All right, well, thank you.
Thank you.
So we've presented to at least a group of people and a couple people from Brookfield as well a month ago about the Abandoned Housing Initiative, which the AG's office has. So generally, we can, you know, give you a really brief overview of where we started. We started in 2008 with the foreclosure crisis, when we saw a lot of blighted properties across the state. And we saw sort of a way we would be able to help municipalities with a lot of those blighted properties. And we've been going since then and going strong, working with quite a few municipalities. I believe we hit 100 municipalities that we work with across the state. So basically what our program does, we work through the state sanitary code and use the receivership statute, which is MGL 111, section 127I, to request to help towns with their vacant and blighted properties. The statute allows for the Attorney General's office or the town to request that the court appoint a receiver when there are violations at a property that won't be promptly remedied and the appointment of the receiver is in the best interest of occupants or in vacant properties cases in the best interest of the public. So that's the general statutory framework that we work under. So we'll work closely with your Board of Health because it's under the state sanitary code, and that's enforced by the Board of Health. Essentially, we start with some vacant and blighted properties, and we'll come out and look at them with your municipality. I'll step back and explain a little bit more what a receiver does. So if a receiver is appointed, they're appointed for the purpose of remedying the code violations present at the property. And through the receivership statute, at the end of that process, they can place a lien on the property for the amount of their repairs. And those repairs are limited to violations of the state sanitary code only. So those are, the state sanitary code meets the minimum standards of human habitability. And it's, you know, it's laid out pretty clearly what violates the state sanitary code. And the receiver, so that lien at the end, the receiver can then foreclose on their lien and recoup their costs, or an owner or interest holder is always able to pay off that lien, and the property stays in the same ownership as it was before. The property is, you know, never changes ownership until that lien is actually foreclosed upon. It's always still the owner, and the mortgages exist until the end of, the very end of the process if it's foreclosed on. So the first step, you know, we take with municipalities is meeting with them like this, and then, you know, letting you all talk and decide what properties you'd like to refer to our office. And we, you know, we work with different municipalities that take different approaches to this referral process. Some only refer bank-owned properties. Some look at specific areas that they, you know, like a specific neighborhood that has a lot of blighted properties, and they may choose to focus on that area because they think that revitalization in that area would have a huge benefit on the whole community. Some look at specific properties that get tons of complaints. So we sort of let the municipality decide those, because you all know your communities way better than I will. So really, you know which properties are the worst, which properties need this program. So after you've sort of made your list, we'll go out and look at those properties with you and sort of do an inspection of them. From there, I'll tell you if it makes sense for the program. There are some properties that are too good. You know, they just have tall grass. They may get a ton of complaints, but they just have tall grass, and that's really not what the receivership statute is for, is, you know, mowing the lawn. And then there are some that are too bad. The receiver couldn't recoup their costs at the end of a receivership if they made those repairs. And then there are lots in the middle. And there are some that the tax liens are too high that a receiver couldn't recoup their costs either. So once we sort of decide which ones make sense for the program, my office will do a title investigation to find the owners and the updated addresses and any mortgage holders and anyone with an interest in the property, whether it's an execution or a mortgage or whatever. We'll find those. Then we send letters to all of those interest holders. And those letters basically say there are violations. And if we're giving you a chance to contact me to make repairs to these properties, or we are authorized to request that the court appoint a receiver. And in the packets that are on the front table here, if anyone wants to grab one at the end, there's a copy of kind of generally what our, and they're also in your binders, generally what our demand letters look like. So we're always willing to work with an owner or an interest holder if they're willing to make these repairs. And that's why we send this letter out with the most updated addresses and the most updated information. So then in a majority of our cases from sending out that letter alone, we get someone to make repairs to the property. And it's the minority of cases that we end up going to housing court and filing and requesting that the court appoint a receiver for those properties. Once we request that the court appoint a receiver, the court has a list of receivers who are approved by the court. So the court checks that they'll be able to fund these repairs, that they'll be able to, that they know how to do this type of work. The court will check on all those things, and then it'll appoint one of those receivers from the list. And they go pretty sequentially to make sure it's fair to all the receivers who have applied to the Worcester Housing Court. So that's very generally sort of the process that we take, and all the municipalities we've worked with, we've found that, you know, we do get great results, and we're able to really help turn around some neighborhoods that are blighted, and a lot of times it is from an owner or a mortgage holder who's willing to make those, who gets that letter, and is willing to make those repairs and is willing to take the next steps that are necessary to make repairs. So that's, you know, very, very broadly our process. And in your booklets, there are some examples of some properties in other municipalities that we've worked with. So then I guess if there are any questions, is that...
I have one question. The word that I heard, the only reason why I would go along with something like this is violations.
Mm-hmm.
So I would look, I saw the chair of the Board of Health. Are there any violations in town?
That would be my question. What criteria meets violation under the state sanitary code for human habitation besides the septic system?
Yeah. So the state sanitary code, there are a lot of violations under the state sanitary code, and most ones we see very often are properties that, you know, the roof is in serious disrepair, so it's very damaging to the structure of the property. There's rubbish and debris over all the property. It's sort of become a dumping ground for neighbors and things like that. Often there are sheds or something at the back that are in very serious condition and are, you know, collapsing onto a neighbor's yard. Those are all very...
But honestly, is that really a violation of the state sanitary code? Because it's private property, and these people are paying the taxes, and they choose to live in this home or in this, but they're not habitating the property, and they're paying their property taxes. How could we come onto their property and say that it shed falling down is a violation of the state sanitary code?
So the state sanitary code sets the minimum standards of human habitability for any residential property, whether it's occupied or vacant. So that's sort of where that comes in. And access to the property, we usually refer you to town council, and there are ways to get access through administrative search warrants and different ways like that, because boards of health are authorized to inspect properties, including vacant properties, because the sanitary code applies to both vacant and occupied properties.
Right, I understand that. If there's a health concern and somebody could get hurt, I can understand that. But if it's a private piece of property, person owns it, they're paying their taxes on it, and no one's living in it, what gives us the right to go to this property and say, hey, I don't like the color of your house, paint it, or I'm going to hire somebody to paint your house? That's the thin line of the part that I'm having.
And Monica, just for clarification, he's not just a resident. Well, he is a resident, but he's our chairman of the Board of Health, so he's speaking from...
I think, if I could answer briefly, I think one of the issues that the sanitary code is meant to address is, while it may be private property, we know that, unfortunately, not everyone, particularly someone who's looking for shelter, may, you know, respect property lines. It's not ideal. We don't favor someone helping themselves through property, but you have children who explore vacant land. You may have adults who for whatever reason don't have shelter, and they seek shelter on someone else's property. And if you have a building or a structure that is in danger of collapse, or has floorboards that are in danger of collapse, or is lacking heat, which is another condition of habitability. There are a variety of concerns that may not affect the property owner, but could affect someone else who happens upon that property.
Right, but they're trespassing on that property in the first place, so they're not supposed to be there.
They may not be supposed to be there, but I think there is, you know, a concern, you know, for the general public welfare that, you know, trespassing may be a citable offense and something they should be cited for, but we wouldn't recommend that they be injured, you know, in the process of trespassing.
In addition to, emergency responders who may have to respond to something at the property, that if it is in an unsafe condition would be dangerous to them as, you know, our emergency responders who are looking out for the safety, whether it be, you know, a fire that could start in a variety of ways or something like that, that's a safety concern as well.
Yeah. So I understand the town chooses the initial list. So it's really the town that needs to come together to agree. Now, the one thing that I didn't hear about was water. Is clean water available to a facility that would not pass? If water shut off to a building or residence, they couldn't habitate there, am I correct?
Water is a violation, having no water is a violation of the state sanitary code, and it usually is one, and it is one that will deem it to be unsafe, the conditions to be unsafe.
So yes. Just picking those where the water's been shut off, maybe is as simple a cutoff as
yes, other than that, if a property was in pristine condition other than no water, that may not be enough of a violation for the court to say, yes, we'll appoint a receiver to this property. If that was the only thing wrong with it, that it would sort of meet that not bad enough that it would be a candidate for receivership. But that often is a good, we have found municipalities that use signals like that as a starting place to determine which properties to look at initially, whether it's, because those are things that the town knows, you know, when water gets shut off and things like that. So we have seen that that's sometimes a valuable tool for a municipality to use to sort of track these properties or start a list like that.
And other issues that we see that often get municipalities interested are areas that may cause children to be injured. So playground equipment that's in decay on a vacant property, swimming pools that are empty or not properly secured, other bodies of water that may need some sort of, that may be able to be contained or addressed to protect children who, you know, may wander onto someone else's property. But I think, you know, kids are just a lot less predictable than adults. And so that at times is something that gets municipalities interested in securing at least those identifiable properties.
We had a couple other questions. We'll start back there, then we'll move up. Go ahead.
I have two questions. How is this initiative funded?
So
the
this
legislature ever approved this program?
So it's funded, do you?
Sure, I can answer that. The majority of this funding comes through settlements reached by the Attorney General's office at the height of the mortgage crisis. So we dealt with several large banks who had engaged in improper lending and foreclosure practices. In 2012, we received a settlement for $45 million. A portion of that was used to fund foreclosure-related assistance for homeowners, and a portion of that was set aside to help fund this program. So this money is actually coming directly from the banks as part of settlement proceeds.
So let me follow up with that. So the legislature has never authorized or approved this program by the Attorney General, correct?
Well, they have authorized the statute that authorizes us to act under the Receivership Act.
Well, let me ask you another question about the statute, because this strikes me as a unique application of the state sanitary code. And recall, the Fifth Amendment to the U.S. Constitution provides property rights. So the question I have to you, since this is a rather unique application that came up during the abandoned housing crisis, has the SJC or any federal court ever reviewed or looked at this program and given its blessing?
The SJC the appeals court has issued an opinion on this matter, and there are, you know, multiple housing courts that have looked at the application to property rights. The ownership is the ownership part of it. It never changes ownership, and that's part of the lien that's placed at the end of the property.
But if I can follow, what's unique about this program is if someone's found a violation, you can appoint a receiver who then can go fix the property. If the person who does the repairs is not compensated, they're allowed to place a lien on the property and seize the property. So the question I ask is this ever, because I don't think this has ever been reviewed by the U.S. Supreme Court.
It would only be reviewed if a case in controversy brought it up, and I would refer you to town council for those type of questions
about it. Well,
I'm raising the issue
whether this program has ever been fully looked at by the court.
I don't believe that, Monica gave you a rundown of the courts that have reviewed this program, including the local housing courts, which are part of the Superior Court, and the Massachusetts Appeals Court. The SJC has not seen reason to take a second look at any of the Mass Appeals Court or Housing Court decisions.
Because nobody's appealed it and it's become case law within the Commonwealth.
That's correct.
You had your hand up.
Well, I mean, the town already has the authority, and let's say a property burns and it's just sitting there and it's a danger. The town already, in our town, has done this. We've torn properties down and put a lien, buildings down and put a lien on it. We already can do that.
Yes, correct.
And the town, you know, the town has, under, the towns also have authority to board properties and place liens for those things as well. And the town, actually, under the statute, those municipalities are authorized to request that the court appoint receivers as well.
So what actually constitutes an abandoned property? How do you know it's abandoned?
So for the purposes of our program, we generally mean vacant. You know, HUD and things like that have specific definitions of abandoned. Since the statute applies to both applies to occupied properties as well, we sort of take a pretty lenient standard on abandoned. It's mainly, you know, it's partially a requirement that to, you know, manage our own time to take on only vacant properties. So we, you know, we use a pretty lenient definition, is as long as someone's not living in it right now. That would be...
Well, that's where the town needs to focus, in my opinion, is that abandoned piece. And to me, it's the violation piece.
Mm-hmm. I think that's the important part, is for the town to make its own priority list. Because, and we take our cue
because
from
we are a small town. You know, you reference properties such as Brockton. Mm-hmm. Anyone that's worked in Brockton, you know, God bless Brockton. But we're not Brockton.
Right.
And we've heard words float around this town for the past couple months of witch hunt. And that's not what we're doing.
Oh, absolutely not. I mean, our hope here is to be able to help towns and other municipalities that find themselves struggling with vacant properties that are causing health concerns. So we don't know those properties, and that's why we look to the town to make those decisions. But really, what we're trying to offer is assistance in those situations for towns that don't have the resources to handle. I mean, as Monica said, the sanitary code allows the town to do this itself, but that we also understand this is a resource issue, and we have some resources then, and we're happy to provide them to help towns to address these issues and return properties that may not be currently on the tax rolls or having taxes paid, return those back to the tax rolls and to productive use, so that you have, you know, occupied productive properties.
So, Kermit and Peter, have you guys looked into the Finney property? Would this be part of that?
Well, Finney property has already been taken under tax title, so that's a question back to you guys. I guess, does that make it ineligible or not a good choice from your point of view?
Well, we don't hold the deed on it.
No, but it's already been taken.
All right.
The tax collector has taken the property. So if
there's a tax lien on the property, that we will often take ones that already have tax liens on them. If you're in the process of going through the land court and
we're not, because it's a pretty big issue in the town of Brookfield. There was an oil spill.
Okay.
It's contaminated. Mm-hmm. We've gone through phase two, I believe, of the system.
Phase two.
Yep.
We have, you know, plans. Obviously, we don't have the money for it, and there is an additional lien mm-hmm. for the cleanup of the property
okay.
through, I believe, the state.
Okay.
So,
okay.
To me, that would be an ideal piece of property to take advantage of if we could.
And I was dressed for success today, and so that was to, in fact, meet with Representative Berthium on the next steps and his next steps. So
has he pursued anything?
He has, and that this is under the Brownfield activity.
Okay. Yeah.
And so with that, that there is money. There was a misunderstanding as to who owned the property as of this morning. There is no misunderstanding now.
They own it, correct?
They own it.
Correct.
And that we need to find $400,000 in that fund.
Would this be...
And this would not. This would...
Could
this would
property?
My perspective at the moment, to do something like this would be complicate matters.
Mm-hmm.
And where I would head with it would be... The thing that I hear is that if you then pursue this, it's you're writing a letter from the AG's office to people that are kind of at worst borderline, at best maybe borderline,
mm-hmm.
and that by you doing that, you motivate someone to do something that you typically don't have receivers.
Correct.
That's correct.
Yeah.
And so it's like pointing out a number of properties to say you need to do something, and that's just fair.
Right, and then you know, we always give the owner a chance to make those repairs, and then if we don't, see any progress or hear anything from anyone, that's when we would, you know, take the next step to request the appointment of a receiver. And even throughout that process, if an owner steps up then and, you know, shows up when they'll get served all of the documents for the court case, they could come in the day of court and say, hold on, I'm willing to do this, and we'll work with them then as well. So we, throughout the whole process, we're willing to work with an owner or interest holder who wants to make repairs to the property.
So if we had a list of vacant properties, not occupied, mm-hmm. and their water was shut off, that would be a good place to start.
Mm-hmm. Yep, that'd be a good place to start, yep. And I think we had a couple more questions.
I had a question also.
Yeah.
One of my questions, I don't know if you fully answered it, because I know the chairman of the Board of Health had asked you, what if on this abandoned property, what if the owner is paying the taxes on this property? Do you still take them and it would go into like a receivership if they don't want to, you know, do anything to the property?
So under the, so there's sort of two parts of this. One, as a policy for the town, you don't want to go use properties that are up on their taxes, that would be your decision. Under the state sanitary code, there's no requirement about whether or not they're paying their taxes. It's really whether there are violations of the state sanitary code that allows for receivership. But certainly towns have different criteria they use to decide which properties they refer to us, and that, you know, that hypothetically could be a criteria that you use.
All right, thank you.
And I think I had one there, and then you.
Just a quick one, Monica. In their earlier session, rather than giving you a list of 20, 30, or 40, you suggested a much more conservative number of 10 or something like that.
If starting with 10 is usually good, mainly not that you can't make a longer list, but for my own, you know, I cover municipalities in all of Worcester County. So for my own kind of workload, I try to limit it to about 10 per municipality at a time. So it doesn't mean we can't take on more in the future, but just sort of to recognize that I work with a lot of other municipalities, I try to limit it to about 10 active from one municipality at a time. And it could be less, and, you know, I certainly work with municipalities that have less than that as well. So it's not a magic number you have to reach 10. It just is for, you know, mainly to manage my own caseload.
And it may be that starting with the criteria that you laid out, filtering by whatever the town decides regarding tax status, and then having, you know, the Board of Health inspections conducted, you rank the, you know, the worst or the most dangerous first, and that's generally where we would start. But obviously that ranking is up to you, and it may be that there are certain aspects of abandoned properties that cause you more concern than others. It may be playgrounds, it may be swimming pools, it could be, you know, caving in roofs, whatever in your mind trips it to be the worst properties that you want to address first, that's where we start. You know, and some go really quickly because the demand letters get responded to very quickly. Others take a lot more time, depending if the owner comes in and tries to make repairs, or, you know, the receivership process can take a while if we end up going that route, but...
Or the repairs are large, you know, if the repairs require large building permits and things like that, that, you know, that obviously adds time to the process as well.
But in the vast majority of our cases, the demand letter resolves the issue. Receivership is our option of last resort, and it is one that we do not turn to lightly or quickly.
Yeah, go ahead.
Is there an exact definition of blighted properties? Or is that just a generalization?
That's more of a generalization, kind of a word to describe.
Because my concern is what one person would look at as beautiful, another person would look at with disdain. And I'm afraid that that's what's going on.
And that's where the sanitary code is helpful. You know, it doesn't dictate paint colors. It doesn't dictate any of that kind of thing. It really is there to dictate the, you know, the minimum standards for living. So, you know, if it's painted bright green, but it's up to code, then it won't, then it doesn't, then that doesn't matter. So it, that's where the sanitary code is sort of the starting point for this. And I think you had a question then back there. Go ahead.
First off, my name's Al Jones. I'm with the assessor's office. Fairly new for anybody that hasn't seen me. Feel free to stop in at any time and ask any questions. What about camps, seasonal places like that? How does that, who sets the criteria on things like that?
So there are regulations under the same kind of regulations for, but they're specifically for camps. I'm not sure what their CMR citation is, but I can certainly email that to someone if that would be helpful. We haven't seen many that under the state sanitary, under the receivership statute, and I'd have to do, you know, a little research to see whether it would apply to a camp as well, looking at, you know, how they, how the camps are classified within the code itself.
Like a campground, or are you talking about a seasonal property.
Yeah.
Or something that somebody, you know, it doesn't even have to be like people think of something on the water, but it could be something that
or a senior that's doing 6 and 6 that'll winterize their house.
Right. If those water. those would sorry, I was thinking more like a campground, because those have a specific statutory or specific regulations. But if it's a home that people live in more seasonally, those are certainly still residential properties.
But when you say they have a certain, those have a certain set of regulations, like it's different than what you said.
A campground has different sanitary code regulations.
I'm saying just for somebody that owns a property that has a small house on it,
yep,
they only use it in the summertime. They use it 6 and 6 or whatever.
Those are still residential properties under 105 CMR 410.
So if their well's not winterized, they're in trouble? I mean, that, those are the kind of things I'm trying to...
Okay. Yeah, so... No, so yes and no. I mean, if it's a property that you'd need more than just they forgot to cover their well this winter, assuming it's, you know, kids aren't falling into the well, things like that. But certainly it still falls under the state sanitary code.
So I got a series of them here, so if you get tired of listening and you want to take another question, go.
So why don't we pop back and, okay.
Well, I was wondering, this is a right-to-farm town, mm-hmm. and there are a lot of people in town that have farm equipment and that sort of thing. Have you, and that's going back to what one person thinks is fine, and another person says, oh, that's horrible, because not everybody is going to keep their maybe equipment bright orange all the time, you know, because it's a workable thing. And are there anything you've come across in reference to properties like that?
So we definitely work with other right-to-farm communities, and, you know, typically I would say, it's, you know, there, it wouldn't need to be more than someone has their farm equipment in their front yard. The times I've seen where it's a farm is when it's been vacant for like 10 years and they have an RV in the front yard and they have oxygen tanks in the backyard. And so there's, you know, they're a falling down barn next to it. So more than just they park their farm equipment here on occasion. That wouldn't qualify it for my program. I would look at that and say that, you know, this isn't a violation that's bad enough with just a tractor parked in the front yard. There'd need to be more. Did we have any? Okay, I'll come back to you after I get the...
sanitary codes come to mind with septic systems. How do you deal with on-site septic?
Yeah, so we have had cases where, you know, there have been septic failure, and if it gets to receivership, that's something that the receiver will address. Obviously, you can't always tell, I can't always tell if a septic is going to be good or not, just from looking at it. But if a receiver is appointed, they will get their Title V inspection and everything like that. If it's an owner and septic looks like it may be a concern, we'll certainly talk to them and be willing to work with them to find, I know septic can often be very expensive, to find reasonable solutions to some of those issues. If it's a septic that's not necessarily in danger of, you know, doing anything to anyone else, well, you know, we can always talk about whether it's something that needs to be addressed at that time. So, Does that answer your question generally?
Generally.
It's hard to say, you know, so many of these become case specific, that it's hard to kind of say generally this always happens when there's a septic system. So it's, you know, I've had cases where the receiver goes in and worked for a, you know, made a lot of repairs of the property and then discovered that the septic needed to be fixed and, you know, had to add all of those costs on. So times when it wasn't discovered until later on. So it just, we have someone in our office who works with septic systems slightly more often than I do. So I usually call her and say, "What do? I think I might have a septic problem." But we work really case by case basis. If it's, you know, depending on what an owner's willing to do and what they have funds to do, septic could be something that may not need to be done right now, and we can kind of work with them for that as well. Go ahead.
Can you give me a name of a couple of communities the size of Brookfield that are local to us that are doing this?
Yeah, so we actually have a map in here. So Spencer has started working with us pretty recently. Let me see, I'm pulling up my map. And I believe, so I know Ware isn't in Worcester County, but I believe the person who works in Western Mass, in our Western Mass office, she works in Ware. And let's see what other communities. I have a little map, but I don't know what they all are. And I could send a list of more of them as well. You know, we have a lot that work in Western Mass as well, so smaller kind of communities like that. You know, we work, so it's not just big towns. We work in Athol, we work in Royalston, so we have a lot of smaller municipalities as well, so they may not be west, but I could send you a list of a few more too if that would be helpful. I don't have them all off the top of my head because it's...
I'm more interested in the list that's going to get presented to the board. That's where I'm at. I'm a conservative guy. I have a hard time telling someone they have to do something to their property. I respect the children issue, but then we'd have to fence all our lakes, all our ponds, all our oceans. There is an accountability for parenting in the world where they have to watch their kids, but at the same time, they're kids. And I understand that double-edged sword. So,
and it's a fine line we try to walk, and we really do work with the municipalities to identify, you know, particular draws for kids.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's really, you know, we see a lot of ones that have structures that will be damaging neighboring lots. So a shed that's collapsing onto, or a garage that's collapsing onto the neighbors.
And in mind of Brookfield, I think of a house that's falling apart right next to a recreational field.
Right. So things like that. Yeah. So it could be that those are the ones that, as a municipality, you kind of choose to focus on ones that may have impacts to the, you know, two neighboring areas, whether it's, you know, from a collapsing building or from a, you know, vacant pool that's never been covered right in the backyard, or even if it's, you know, become a dumping ground for tons of things within the municipality. That could be something that you sort of choose as one of your criteria, is its impact to the adjacent lots or the, you know, the area around it. Okay. In the back, and then...
The people that do the receivership, the wages that they are paid for doing, or, I mean, obviously they're spending their own money, charges are going to be incurred. How is it decided how much the person who's doing the repairs is charging, say, per hour for doing, say, carpentry or whatever? Mm-hmm.
So they file monthly reports with the court and with all of the parties in the case who have shown up. So I get a copy of all of the monthly reports. The court gets a copy of all the monthly reports. And we all, you know, and any party who, you know, any party will get a copy of those as well. We all review it for reasonableness. Parties can always come in and object to any costs if they feel that they are too high or they're unnecessary. The receivers also file a budget at the outset of the case, and parties can come in and object to that budget as well. So if they feel that the budget is, you know, covers too many items, or there's a cost on the budget that's too high, a party, including our office, which, you know, the receiver works as an agent of the court, so the court reviews these very closely to make sure that, the you know, they're doing the work in a very reasonable manner. Our office reviews them closely because we want to make sure the integrity of the statute and the integrity of the receivership is held. So we review them very closely, and you know, we'll send if something's off, even if it's a receipt that shows a different amount than what's in their calculation, we'll talk to them and say, you need to provide me with a different receipt or change this.
So are they getting prevailing wage, or are they getting?
So they it really is set as a reasonable rate. And it depends on the type of work.
Well, that's relative. Like that. So reasonable rate for me, I'm a carpenter, I'll pay $15 to a laborer. Prevailing wage is $40.
It depends on, I can't say yes, they always use prevailing wage, or no, they don't. It depends. It's case by case. It depends on the property, the receiver, things like that. Go ahead.
Let's say the Selectmen agree that this is a worthwhile program and that they want to get started on it. And then you get to the point of deciding which properties are highest priority, most dangerous, most safety violations, whatever. Then they refer that list to you. You look it over and you say, yeah, they all look pretty good here.
Mm-hmm.
How do you determine what needs to be done?
Yeah, so that will come from so we'll work with the Board of Health to get a list of the violations of the state sanitary code. And so, you know, usually we'll get a violations report from the from the Board of Health, and that will be the list we go by. And so some, you know, and even with that list, you could choose to not cite everything, but typically we sort of take an approach of try to cite, you know, what you see when you go to the property. So, but it'll be from that list that we'll be able to determine, and those will be all determined by the state sanitary code. They'll all be, you know, only violations of the state sanitary code.
So that's the point at which the Board of Health would get involved,
mm-hmm.
unless they were the board that was the lead board on this program.
Yeah. So they'd need to be involved at that stage, you know, and if the town would like it or earlier, but at least at the stage of when they're referred to my office, we'd need help from the Board of Health to know what violations were there and to get that report.
I'd just like to say I know people are concerned that your office, whoever's going to run this program, is going to start a witch hunt or looking at properties that really shouldn't be looked at. I have three properties on my street that somebody ought to look at. I mean, there's water in the basement, they're unsecured, there are cats in and out of them, there's a dead raccoon on the front lawn, there's brush fallen down. You know, something needs to be done, and the house next door is just as bad. So, if you want a blight, that's blight in my neighborhood, and down the street probably is a house that you wouldn't want because it's been abandoned, but it's a teardown. So I presume that's not the kind of property you deal with.
Typically, teardowns, demo properties won't be good candidates for the program. I usually say if you have one that you're like, yes, we need to do something about this, and you're not sure, you know, you can always refer it to me, and the worst that's going to happen is I'll say, no, I think this one has too many violations.
See, when he says something like that, I think we're on the same page with that piece of property.
Two properties.
Well, the one that I'm thinking on, Kimball.
Those
are the properties that I would refer to as a Board of Selectmen, because those are blights, those are violations, those are the health hazards to our children that we can't do anything about.
I hear a lot of times that demo is the only option, and I would say refer them anyway, because often receivers can do, they work with distressed properties all the time. That's sort of what they do. So often, even if to others it feels like it can only be demoed and that's the only way to solve it.
It's an only demo.
Okay. Yeah. Well, in that case, it's probably not a good one to refer to our program. The court doesn't, at least our court in Worcester doesn't allow receivership for demos, because under the state sanitary code is minimum standards of human habitability, which demoing a property would not meet that. Even if it's the safest or something like that, it's not bringing it back up to minimum standards of habitability.
But if you have these other two properties in the
right.
those would be ones we could definitely look at.
And they're bank-owned. You know, it's not like we're, you know,
we deal with a lot of
there.
Bank-owned properties, actually.
And we deal with a lot of some municipalities who sort of choose to only look at bank-owned properties or something like that. You know, as sort of some of the first properties they'll look at, they'll sort of limit it to bank-owned.
And
at first.
On your list, how many do we have bank-owned that are blighted? Do we have the 10 that are bank-owned?
We don't know.
We have a tentative list.
But originally,
most of those we prioritized were essentially, they're not bank-owned. The title is still, in a lot of them, is still in the original owner's name. The bank is paying the taxes on it. Mm-hmm. So it's, for instance, the house next to me, vacant for 2 years. The title is still in their name. The bank is paying the taxes. On that list, we kind of prioritized, and those were the ones that were the highest. But the number, I'm not sure.
But we didn't include on the list anybody that was already in tax title. So the list could have a lot more properties on it than, because we understood that if the town had already acted, tax collector had taken the property, that you wouldn't deal with that.
I don't know that we have dealt with any thus far that have already been taken.
No, we have
tax.
Quite a few that have taken, in you have tax liens placed, like recorded with the registry tax lien,
right.
But you haven't filed anything in land court. So that's,
okay.
Yeah.
That
so
we could do.
We handle those quite a bit, where there's a tax lien on the property. And actually, the receivership statute, the tax liens take priority over the receiver's lien, so those tax liens would get paid off if it got to the stage of a receivership. That tax lien would still take priority over the receiver's.
So you
lien.
Might just get 20 properties from the town of Brookfield.
So are there any other questions? I know I saw a few other hands before, so... go ahead. I know I've said I'd come back to you many times.
So the receiver, the piece I don't understand here is you have a property, and now you say, okay, we're going to give this, the state comes in, okay, you folks say, we're going to give this property to these people to renovate. Is there a bid process so that multiple people, so that somebody just doesn't come in and charge $80 an hour or charge for 800 hours, but they do it in two? And then they can take title on themselves and jack up the
So that's not how the initial process, that's not how it works. We will file a case in the housing court to request that the court appoint a receiver. The court has a list of receivers who have been approved by the court. So to get approval, you have to show that you can get an insurance bond for the amount that you'll be spending on them. You have to show you can get insurance to cover your construction.
License,
you have to show, yep, you have to show your licenses, that you have to provide references to say that you can do this type of work. And from that list, the court, under the SJC's court rules, you go on fee-generating appointments, so appointments with any court that generates a fee, that generates a profit to, could generate a profit to a person. You have to create this list and go sequentially down the list. That's how the court, that's one of the court's requirements, and that's how the court will do it. So they'll go sequentially down the list.
So the right of refusal?
What?
It's a right of refusal?
Yep, so if a receiver, you know, for whatever reason isn't willing to take the property, the court will move to the next receiver on that list, and we'll go from there. So it's, you know, to make sure it's fair to everyone and to address your question about fees and things like that, that's where really the court's review of all of the budget and all of the receivers' reports, so they file monthly reports with all their receipts, all their invoices, all of their charges, and if anything seems unreasonable or not right, the court can question that and can strike items, and my office can question any of those and object to any of those. Any party in the any party to the case, so any interest holder, any owner can object to any of those items throughout the process. So that's, you know, if you see, for example, replaced a window 400 hours. Very, you know, very exaggerated example. But if I saw that in a report, I would, you know, the court as well as my office and probably any party would object to that item in the report. And the receivers, and you know, the only costs that they get recouped at the end are the costs that went into those monthly reports. And the court and my office check all of those reports very thoroughly.
Okay.
I saw quite a few more hands. Go ahead.
How large is the group?
At the AG's office? I cover all of Central Mass. We have an attorney in our Springfield office who covers all of the four western counties. We have an attorney who covers Greater Boston area, one who does the Northeast, and then like one and a half that does the Southeast, and Amber is the director of our program. So we have about six. So we're a pretty small program statewide.
And do you work in a concentrated area once it's been determined, or do you bouncing all over?
So I specifically work in all of Worcester County, plus a few. So I basically work in any city or town that's covered by the Worcester Housing Court. So all of Worcester County, and then there's a few outliers that are, you know, in other counties. But essentially Worcester County, I'll only cover Worcester County. Other questions? I think we maybe had one over here. Did you have a question?
Yeah. Talking about the repairs from the contractors, who's going to oversee these guys? You just explained that, but I mean, $400 for putting a window in. But these guys can still charge outrageous amounts of money to the homeowner. And if someone is owning the property, they're going to have to pay this bill later. Is that what you're telling me? And they're not going to have any say. I mean, they're probably going to charge four times the amount a regular contractor would.
So at any point in the receivership, so this is only if it gets to receivership. So this is only our the small percentage of our cases. But if it gets there, the owner can object to any of those items as well, and they'll see they'll get a copy of the monthly reports. My office will get that. Any interest holders, that's the owner, the mortgage holders, anybody else who, you know, has a recorded interest, execution, something like that, they'll get notice. They'll get those monthly reports as well, and those show the invoices, those show the hours, and if there's something that they don't think is reasonable, it can be the amount they're charging, it can be the number of hours, they can object to those as well.
So if a homeowner can't afford this, you guys can just go in and do it anyway, no matter what.
So,
you understand my question? Pretty much, if a homeowner can't make the repairs that he'd like to make, but he can't make them, you people are still going to come in and do them anyway, and then you're going to put a lien on his place.
Well, I think the important thing to keep in mind for our program is that we're focused on vacant properties. So we're not going in and foreclosing on someone's property that they're living in. That is not our aim or our goal. And rather, if a property owner cannot afford to make the repairs, to the extent they're necessary to protect the safety of the public good, that's what we're limited at. So we're not going in and putting in granite countertops and brand new bathrooms, or, you know, making luxury accommodations at high cost. The goal of receivership is merely to return it to a habitable condition so that it is safe and secure.
Well, what if what if it's a house in an estate? Mm-hmm. And you're still going to come in and do it anyway?
So we'll give notice to any potential heirs of the estate, and they can certainly work with us as well. And that's part of the process that our title investigators, when we sort of at that very early stage, they'll find addresses and names for any heirs, and they have a chance to make repairs to the property as well. And often in estates, especially when they're vacant and blighted, often heirs won't want anything to do with the property. They won't see it as worth their time or money. But certainly if an heir does want to make repairs, we'll work with them, and we'll work with them to get the property.
Well, if they're paying the taxes on the property, obviously they do care. And that's the situation in this town. We have a few that are empty, and it's in the state, and they are making the taxes.
So we
can't just say they don't care, and they're not going to get involved.
I wasn't saying all the time. I'm saying on occasion, you know, right. We see estates in other municipalities, and on occasion they aren't, you know, they aren't interested in making the repairs. In those cases, they may be, and we'd certainly be willing to work with them as well.
And one other thing, I think our town is concerned about really bad-looking properties, and you're talking about if it's in tax lien, you might not do it, and that house on Kimball Street that's burnt out, that's probably the worst one that the town is talking about, and we're not going to do anything about it. So that kind of concerns me. You know, we're kind of contradicting ourselves here. Well, we're trying to get the bad places cleaned up, and now you're saying, well, if it's this, it's that, we can't do it.
Now, I think that was my confusion. There are different stages of tax lien and tax taking. If it's at a tax lien stage, we're happy to look at the property. There's a next step that the town could take, foreclosing on that tax lien. It doesn't sound like that's what the town of here has done, and so that complication is not something we need to worry about right now. If it's simply imposition of a lien, we deal with properties with liens on them all the time. And in fact, putting it through this program would potentially get that lien paid back, which is something that otherwise it will just sit on the property for, you know, until something else happens with the property until it's sold. So this may be a way to get that tax money returned to the city.
And to sort of answer your other kind of question, so we have, you know, at the beginning I talked about the properties that are too good and the properties that are too bad. So there are going to be those ones that, you know, that aren't able to be, that wouldn't be able for a receiver to recoup their costs. So that's sort of my initial consideration, is if you know, even though only a small percent make it to receivership, we don't want to send out a letter that we would never be able to follow through on if we had to. So if a receiver couldn't recoup their costs at the end, that property would kind of be too bad for a receivership. And receivership is really, you know, one of the tools that a municipality has. And so, and I know it's frustrating to hear because often the other tools cost money and city municipalities don't have that either often, whether it's demo or something like that. But there are going to be properties that are too bad for receivership. And so that, you know, that may be some of the contradiction there. There are some that won't be viable for receivership.
Monica, you mentioned back. That. I'm sorry.
No, go ahead, and then I'll go to the back.
We were talking a lot about receivership, but I think, as I recall, you said that like less or about 20% ever go to receivership, something like that.
Yep.
Most of them are settled
yep,
in some way or another before they ever get to receivership.
Yep, so that's what from the letter we send out early on, we were talking about this a little earlier, but from the letter we sent out early on, the vast majority of our cases are resolved from that letter alone. So it is a very small percentage, you know, 20 something like that, that'll end up in receivership. But most of the cases most of the properties that are referred will be resolved with an owner or someone making repairs from the letter that they received from our office alone. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
I just want to clarify, the AG's office will only get involved if requested to do so by the town, correct?
Yes. Yes.
Who makes that decision, the Selectmen or the Health Board?
We leave that up to the municipality to determine, you know, how you want to structure that and how you'd like to, and which boards you'd like to.
We've got the answer. We've got the Health Board, the Selectmen. Yeah.
We've met over this a few times, brought to our attention a couple months ago. I believe this board is on board, for lack of better words, with the program. I'm not on a witch hunt. To me, it's the violation piece. It's not that, you know, it's abandoned and a kid can access the house. That's not where I'm at. If we've charged two members of the community to go out, get us a list. We haven't seen that list. We've talked to a few over the phone. A couple of them I agree with. If they can be proven to be a violation of, you know, health issues, that's where I'd ask the Board of Health to weigh in on. And I have no problem as a Board of Selectmen member to forward any type of list to your office. But it would have to be a collective agreement between all three of us.
I would agree that you make good points about the swimming pool, potentially sheds that would fall down onto adjacent properties, things of that nature. That I can see. We're falling in, like you said, safety personnel going into the building and putting themselves into harm's way. Those I can agree with. The word which I have come up quite a bit, I've used it myself. I have not had the privy of the presentation for this. So I was very cautious. Fools rush in, rangers, you know, see the tread.
Yeah.
And I feel that, you know, even though a list has been compiled, you know, this is Charlie's house, or this is Bob's house, leave that one alone. Well, that's Ray's house, so let's go after that. I don't want that. Mm-hmm. I want it to be clear, open, and I want it to help the community. I don't want houses taken off the tax rolls. I want them habitated, and I want it to remain into the property. I don't want my taxes to be but I want this community to persevere through it. When I got on the Board of Health, I told people if there's a health concern, if there's an open
septic system that's bleeding out of a dog, and they get bit by the kid, and all of a sudden we've got some endemic or not. I'm all about it. Somebody's got bicycles in the yard, and they like bicycles in the yard. Well, God bless him, he's got bicycles in the yard, or whatever it might be. So we pick and choose our fights. So my usual break, which I mean, that's serious. There are a lot of people who choose in this community to live in a certain format that other people look after with some disdain. And we have to walk through that government, so I think that echoes the original news. We're on board with it, right? I mean, it's a positive program. I'm just afraid that my person would be in attempts to make things look beautiful.
And we certainly appreciate the dialogue and the amount of thought that's going into all of your decisions. And we never want it to be that it's that we're being used to target one person. That's not our goal either. So really, that's where having this dialogue and finding the criteria that you want to use to pick the properties that you'd like to refer to us is important and really something that can help avoid any of that. So,
Mike, did you have a question?
I was just going to say, have you seen that other communities target specific neighborhoods? Is that generally how they start the process? Is that a better way, in your opinion, to go forward with this?
So we've seen some communities that have taken that approach, and it really, we have seen that often will, if you kind of target look at a specific area, you're able to see more results in one area, see kind of the benefits of it in one area. So it does have that kind of draw to it, and I think that helps a lot of communities. It can really, if there's a downtown or there's some area that really has a lot of blight and that's negatively impacting the neighbors around them and whether people will go there, whether someone will walk on the street, things like that, it can really help in that area. And we have seen, areas where that's been able to, whether from an owner making repairs or receivership, been able to turn an area around and, get CDBG funds and things like that can go to that area as well. So it certainly is something to consider and something that has been helpful in other municipalities as a starting point or as a way to kind of narrow a list or something like that.
So, Carmen and Peter, have you worked with the Board of Health to put a list together, or is it just something that they charged you with, basically saying go over the river and...
I would say it should be, the whole process should be started over based on what we learned here tonight.
Because you excluded the taxes.
Yeah, okay. And for example, the property next to the Lewis Field, we didn't include because we thought it was in tax title. It is in tax title. But now it seems like a pretty good property, and the town would actually save some money instead of having to go to land court.
You might want to talk with Sandy, too, because there's technically two lists out there. One that has, and it's a short list, that's gone to KMP right now for the taking. So that's done. There's nothing we can do there. So you would exclude those. Mm-hmm. But there is another list that she's going to potentially put into that CDBG. No.
CMRPC.
Yeah. CMRPC. So many acronyms in the Commonwealth. their auction program. So that might be something that we don't even have to worry about.
Yeah, so I think we got involved just to try to collect information to say, is this a good program or it isn't? And the Board of Health was still, trying to think about some of these issues to decide whether they wanted to support this program or not. So in effect, any list is in no man's land until the board actually makes a decision to go ahead with the program and then sets up a process.
We've okayed that about 2 months ago. We were just looking for that list, and we have a buy-in from the Board of Health now if there's violation issues.
I see a potential for the town.
So can you two gentlemen work with the Board of Health to get us a list of those 10 properties?
Who do you want to work with the Board of Health?
You and Peter?
I don't think that's necessary.
You don't?
I think they're going to compile a list to present it to you. You make the choice, and then the Board of Health is responsible for going forward
As far as I'm concerned, I wouldn't entertain any list until it's been proven that it's a Board of Health violation.
Well, as I understand it, the way this process was supposed to work is a list would be presented
to the selectmen or one of the boards and then turned over to the AG's office, and the AG would do the initial inspection and then send out the waters.
Peter and Kermit met with us, and we had asked that they meet with you, which I believe they did, and I think you turned it back over to them to generate a list.
Well, there was a list that was presented to us that had 25 different properties on it, and we were supposed to rule it down to 10. And at the end of the conversation, it was like, this is Charlie's house, and this is Bob's house, and this is Charlie's house, and this is
But we got to take Bob's the we got to take the Charlie's off.
I don't know any of these people, and I'm glad that I don't. What I want to do is go to the individual houses and see if there are indeed violations.
And that's where I
enlisted myself, not just because I don't like my next door neighbor's house.
But that's where I need your expertise on that violation piece, because you're the board.
And that's how we left it that night. I said I would like to go out as a board and inspect these properties.
So can they give you guys a list of maybe 20 properties, and you deem you would allow to 10
well,
of them?
We have how many residents in the town? I mean, I'd like to look at all the entire town, not just where you can
But that's
walk.
What that's what they've already done, no?
Well, they did within the where you can walk.
I thought you guys went over the river and did the whole town. Correct?
Me?
No, Kermit.
What do you say?
You included the whole town in blighted properties, correct?
Our initial really just a straw man. We just said, here's a concept of what's going to be. Mm-hmm. We didn't make any decisions about it. And quite frankly, I'm getting a little uncomfortable here. That I get the impression that Peter and I put this list together and we're designating certain houses and certain people. We did not do that. We started off with a list of properties that were where the water was shut off.
Mm-hmm.
That was identified as abandoned property. We identified that. And we put them on a list, and we just threw an idea out there so people could work on it. I do not want to take on responsibility, and I don't think Peter does, of us two exclusively putting together a list.
Well, no, that's where I'd ask.
I would like some of the people here who are uncomfortable with this process to be part of that process as well. Because I got the impression they think I am the one.
No, not at all.
Well, I don't know.
Somebody has to set some criteria as the basis for the list, as you said. And should we be looking at places that are real threats to public safety?
To me, that's why the program exists.
So if that's the criteria, and if you're the board that's setting the criteria,
well, they're the board that sets the criteria. They're the Board of Health. They're the ones that stipulate if there's a violation or not. And that's the word that I hooked onto right away was violation.
Essentially, I mean, if you want that list, there's a violation, and I think I've heard this before, it's very easy to find it.
So I would be looking for the 10 most egregious violations in the town of Brookfield.
I'm not qualified to tell you.
And that's why I wanted the Board of Health to be on board with it, and I'm hoping they are at this point.
Well, I've got a better education from these two young ladies, so.
So how would you recommend that we move forward to bring 10?
To look through the town and find the most blighted property.
Is that something that your board can do in a timely manner? Because this is somewhat of a small time frame, correct? We don't want to wait a year.
So, you know, from our perspective...
Can we silence that phone, please? Thank you.
It usually works better if it's a faster turnaround, but, you know, if it was 3 months from now or 6 months from now, I certainly wouldn't say no to any of the properties. But usually when some of the discussions and things like that are fresher in people's minds, it usually works a little bit better, and you know everyone is able to move forward more on the same page. So usually
well, that's why this meeting is good, because you have the chairman of the Board of Health saying that he's educated on it now and he feels more comfortable, and it's a buy-in process. Dave,
don't you think? I think our town has an obligation to the residents before we get involved with the AG. I think if there is someone has a real direct problem with their property, I think this town has an obligation to send them a letter before we sick the AG people on it. I think we should do that first.
I'm thinking a lot of these properties are bank-owned or abandoned properties.
I think it does matter.
Should
get a letter first.
Because if they're abandoned, that means they really don't care about their neighbors or the community to begin with.
Bank-owned properties, the banks don't even know what they own. I mean, so if somebody alerts them that there's a problem with one of their properties,
they know if they're paying, if they're paying the taxes to make them up to date, they know what they own.
Well, I work for them, and I know a lot of them do not know what's going on. So I think the town.
And that's part of this program is where they send a letter.
So we're right away.
Why not? I think we as a town should do that first, and if we don't get anywhere, then they.
But that's what we are as a town, is we're taking advantage of this tool.
Okay. So if we have to write one more letter, I don't care. Let's write a letter. I'm kind of tired of hearing about it, guys. I mean, quite frankly, we've been talking about we don't want to do this, we don't want to do that. We have complaints about the dollars that we receive to not be able to pay our bills. We've got to do something. I mean, flat out. And so this is, and if it's one more letter, if it's a 50-cent letter to 10 properties, I mean, $5. I'll throw the $5 in.
Well, we got to back up a little. We got to find those 10 properties.
And I'd look to the chairman of the Board of Health and others to
the Board of Health
us.
So is that something you guys can do?
Yes,
in a timely manner?
And we discussed that at that meeting 2 weeks ago.
Yep. I was the one that I attended.
25-point list.
Yep. So we're looking for 10 properties.
We're looking for 10 properties within the perimeters of the town of Brookfield that are the worst of the worst.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but not a bit. Not that we're going to tear them down. I mean, that's
no. We don't want to tear any of them.
Exactly.
Are there suggestions that can be made to that list, or is there a master list that someone will have to be in charge of that? Or
there's only so many residents in the town of Brookfield, right. So we all know of some that are, blatant.
Yeah, I live right across the street from.
See, now they're your neighbors.
I stand.
Everybody's got a neighbor like that.
Yeah,
so in 3,000 population, 3,200, that means it's 1,500 neighbors.
Right.
I don't think we're going after that many people.
Right.
So we're going to find the most egregious ones and we'll work.
So Mr. O'Connell, Mr. Eaton, are you willing to work with the Board of Health to share your knowledge of what you've collected?
Sure.
So maybe on the next Board of Health agenda, entertain
it? As long as it's just the address, not the individual.
However you want to format it.
The last list you got, Dan, had no names on it.
And then once you generate that list, forward it to the Board of Selectmen. If we approve, then we'll forward it to the AG's office.
And we can, if having the Board of Health send a letter first, that's, we can work that into. So it's up
that,
to you.
That would be on the Board of Health, okay. As far as I'm concerned.
Mm-hmm. Okay,
$5.
I appreciate the donation, but I'm not going to sign off on the Board of Selectmen sending a letter. That would have to come from the Board of Health.
Mr. Chairman, one moment, though. You talked about septic, and so I want to be... We've had the opportunity where someone has had an issue with their septic, and they have an issue of funding a septic repair. We want to make sure that we understand that there's documentation in the hallway here of people that can be contacted if people are having issues with septic that need to get funding or find funding, that there's funding there and available, and then further that Cindy Thompson has been very helpful to writing those grants, to help people write those grants. So I think that we want to express, and now we have the TV there.
And Janet, Janet's the one that's in charge of that, correct? Janet came before this board and offered that. We're back into that now. We were excluded from it for a couple of years, but now we have that.
Right, for $900 it's worth it.
So, can I just ask one more thing? Yeah, but you ticked off a number of things that are health and safety violations in the code. Is there a list of them?
So the state sanitary code has hundreds and hundreds of things, but there's a pretty small list of things that are automatically violations that are deemed to endanger. And so that I don't have it on me, but it's in the regulations, which I can send a copy of all of the regulations in an email to whoever would like to get that, because sometimes those are a good place to start, but in general is kind of those few conditions deemed to endanger. Those are usually it's things like water and heat, which may or may not apply to some of them, but they're under the state sanitary code. I believe it's 105 CMR 410 500. That's the kind of general, the more general citation, and that's usually where health inspectors are able to put things like collapsing garages and things like that is under that general provision in the state sanitary code. Yeah.
One thing to keep in mind when you do look at the owner of record, it's not uncommon at all for
a bank not to take, not to put themselves down until the very end. Mm. And then they will, there will be a deed that'll, where they'll buy it out, and then a subsequent deed where it gets turned over to somebody else.
So you're aware of
who the real owners are, is that what you're saying? We don't necessarily know that, no, not until the end. Sometimes they do, there could be, seen cases where there's four or five banks involved, and the bank ends up with a property and they don't necessarily know who, what they have, but they just keep paying the light bill to keep the place freezing up. So I would not necessarily go by the owner of record, and if you're looking at the property, and you might be better off just going with the addresses and not even, you know, not even putting out the names.
And we do see a lot of properties that are sort of in that some stage of foreclosure land, and it could be that it's been going on for a number of years where, you know, the banks, they have documents they have to file along, they have to record with the Registry of Deeds so we can see them along the way, and we can see where that process was started, but that it was never finished. So they, you know, they started foreclosure, but there's not that final deed. So we see that a lot, where, you know, you kind of can see that it's been, that the people would have gotten notice of foreclosure and things like that, but it was never completed.
And that's the advantage of working with the Attorney General's office, in my opinion, because we can do those title searches, we can do things like that without the onus of town money.
For free?
Well, nothing's for free.
But the banks have already paid for this one, so.
Any other questions? Two lovely ladies.
Thank you.
I thank you very much.
Thank
this board. Thanks
you.
I think there's a couple questions from people. If you could stick around,
yes,
sidebars.
Yes, definitely.
And again, thank you very much. And thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Excellent questions. Any discussion from this board? Are we good? Moving forward.
We're good. Okay.
Item number two, I'll entertain a motion to sign the annual town election. Warrant. Do you have a motion?
Oh, I'll make the motion.
A second. Any discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Danny?
Yes, sir.
No second?
Just talk out there. Just talk out there so the mics don't pick you up. Thank you, sir. I don't think he's going far, Carmen.
Yeah, let's roll this.
I have my card just stapled in those. But it's
oh, yeah, I saw.
Just so you know, it has my email and everything on it.
Thank you.
Is there any way we can grab one for the administrative assistant? Thank you.
And then I can leave. These are just like informational packets.
Okay.
There's a bunch of them here.
We can keep them in the Selectman's office in the residence. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. That's it. That's our.
Thank you for coming out.
Appreciate it. Item number three, town hall renovation discussions. I had. I've had. Sorry, we just have an ongoing meeting. I spoke with Mr. Simpson this morning.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very positive discussion.
I did as well. Good.
Before or after me?
After.
After. I riled him up.
Yeah.
Oh, he was calm, cool, and collected when I talked.
He was riled. We were both riled. And I absolutely... The biggest individual that I will support as a selectman is young Bill Simpson.
When he's ready, he's going to be, he
already is a huge asset to this town. I have the utmost respect for him and appreciation. The guy's a powerhouse. We discussed, he met with Mr. Scanlon.
Yep.
He's talking a 3-year phase program for a potential only $100,000 allocation of town funds to get the elevator in through grants and
That's
everything.
Great.
But it'd be a 3-year phase.
Oh, it's got to be. Yes.
Which is just huge. He put water on my fire, calmed me down of wanting to start this phase, and I agreed with him at the end of that conversation.
But the underlying issue is where we take that allocated money, the $50,000 for the bathroom.
Mm-hmm.
We talked last meeting about a public hearing, thinking this morning after that conversation and later throughout the day, cancel the public hearing. And have an article on the special town meeting to transfer that $50,000 to a renovation. And not only a renovation, I came to another idea. Keep this as the assessor's office, build this bathroom. So we keep that office, we have a bathroom here that's ADA accessible, and we don't disrupt the foot plan. We have our meeting hall. When the elevator gets done, we have upstairs, and then we move forward with the downstairs.
So you mean putting a bathroom in this area?
Yeah, plan calls for the men's room to be here.
Correct.
So would it be a men's room and a ladies' room?
It would be a unisex bathroom.
Okay.
For at least the beginning until we build out.
And technically, we can still keep that bathroom, existing bathroom. We don't have to make any renovations to it because this would be our ADA accessible bathroom. So technically, we'd have two bathrooms. I would need money. I would need costs from Plumber and Tantasqua, which I know I can do in 2 months for the special town meeting, and that's where the article would lead.
Yep.
So that's an up or down vote, literally, if the town wants us to move forward with the renovations of this town hall. It gets us our ADA bathroom outside of the plans. We discussed this, and there were no punches hidden or pulled.
No.
The desire was for an ADA bathroom. We met. We were going to have a discussion to put it on as an article in the special town to do this. And I'm kind of glad things are working its way out because it's going to get done, and I want it to be done right.
So I on the idea of a public hearing, and because of all of conversations around it, if we could have an hour and a public hearing or whatever we wanted to call informational, if only that, where we take the architect's study and we say, here is the footprint of the floor as it is envisioned. Here is the layout of the several phases, and oh, by the way, the first two phases of this thing we can fund by grant monies that we can go start beginning in February of 17. We can start to go find that funding so that we move forward with this activity. So that folks are clear that this is the strategy.
You don't want to do that in a special town? Have the educational courses?
I don't have a problem. We
have
need
them before at the meetings. We've had a small informational session.
If we could do it one before, even one during, and just maybe abbreviate the one
during.
I'm
not opposed to it. It's just the same people are going to come out to it.
Oh, yeah. And they may not even show up. But we have the camera. At least get it. Yeah. Let us get in front of
folks.
I'm
not opposed to it. But, again, obviously, this is still a work in progress because I've changed my mind since last week.
Yeah, there's money out there. We just got to figure the right way to go
get
it.
But we want to do it right.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
And now also, when we did pass that article, the $50,000, weren't we also supposed to be doing some work on the some thresholds and also with the handicap ramp?
Yeah, well, not so much the ramp, the door.
The door.
Yeah, so, I mean, that's stuff that within the 50, we probably ought to
and
be
that's, Tantasqua's already been in to look at that a month ago.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And if they're going to do this bathroom, obviously we do it all in one shot.
Okay.
And if it's more than 50, which I'm hoping it's not, to be honest with you, I'm going to solicit a couple plumbers in town to see if they'll be willing to donate time, and we'll pay for material for it.
And speaking of donations, I have a 20-foot screen squirreled away that I haven't brought upstairs yet, an electronic screen so that it's up and down with buttons so that maybe we can protect the picture as we move it to the new location where you can actually have a full screen.
Right. So. Beautiful. So do we want to set a date for public hearing now, or do we want to keep thinking if we want one, or?
I think we ought to wait till the next meeting and then schedule one. Yeah, that's fine. Just more.
So we are going to meet next week. That'll be 3 weeks in a row.
Last week or not. I mean, that'll be so many weeks in a row.
We're here.
Nothing's on the agenda yet.
Well, I'm sure there will be. Me personally, I'd like to meet next week because the next one's not till the 26th.
Okay. Yep, then let's do it.
And that articles are going to be due on the 26th.
Yeah, articles are due.
Oh.
So you want to set the date on the next week's agenda?
Yeah, and I'll look towards Clarence, too. Because as far as I'm concerned, we could do it at a town meeting because it'll be the discussion of the two grants for the elevator.
Yeah, and I'd like Bill to explain it, not me.
The three-year plan.
Yep.
And then the desire to take that $50,000 and build a bathroom here.
And maybe we can work with Sharon after this meeting. I'll chat with her about how best that we can have people be able to see these documents over the television.
All right.
I think the best thing to do is to do it at a town meeting, because I think if you have a public hearing, you're not going to have many people come in.
Oh, yeah, that's what I say. Let's get it on camera. Yeah. Get it out there.
Get it out there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Before town meeting, if that's all that we do.
All right. Item number four, I had asked Karen to put this on DPW. A couple of years we've been talking about melding a couple of departments into a DPW to save the town. Yeah. With the potential retirement of our water commissioner, I think it might be a good time. I had asked Betty to look into laws for, you know, funds or whatnot.
They've talked about this years ago.
I think there's always been a discussion that has to be special legislation. I don't know if that's true or not,
but it's
been thrown out there.
I don't think there's special legislation.
We're a home rule town. Home rule.
So I think probably now is the time to start that conversation and get it ready for the annual town meeting in June. Mm-hmm. To finally pull the trigger on it.
Yeah, we had success with the assessor stuff.
Yeah. I think it's a very good idea.
They've done a good job on what they've done. We've fallen into it. It's time to talk about it.
All right. So I'll try to get more work out of Betty to see what she's got with the state on that, and we'll move forward. If you guys can find anything that I can't find outside of the Betty conversation, maybe through Gobi or...
I do have to follow up. We've talked
to speak with her.
Okay.
By the way, Senator, you know, can you lead us in the direction of what we need?
I'll ask her.
I think it's a very good idea to do that. We've talked about this for years.
Anyway, item number five. This was kind of a surprise. A seasonal highway. I guess the personnel committee voted to approve a wage authorization. I have a problem with it.
I wasn't there this morning because I had my grandson, so I can't tell. Mary Lou's here. Maybe she can tell you something about
it. I think it falls within it, probably the experience, but the conversation that we've had in the past month is that this isn't a $15 an hour position, and that's what they're requesting.
Oh, no, okay. There's two discussions about seasonal. One is a $15 position that you paid for last year, or we did pay for last year, and that's what that's talking about. There's a second seasonal worker as to the lawn mowing and those activities. That's a separate activity.
I'm going to argue that I would only approve one seasonal worker.
Oh, I thought it was just going to be one seasonal worker.
That was my assumption
I'm under the impression you're going to do what you did last year, and you've got to do more.
No, it was my impression. Well, you can correct me, Mary Lou, if I'm wrong. We had discussed it. Wasn't it supposed to be one person?
One person seasonal.
Yeah.
One person to do whatever needed.
Then I'm confused.
I'm not going to have five people down the highway.
No, I was going for two, but that's all right.
Well, we are in three currently.
Yeah.
And if
seasonal workers.
I'm on board with one seasonal.
Yeah,
seasonal.
And I was under the impression it was two.
No, one.
So do we want to have a discussion with the highway department?
Sure.
Because I wouldn't vote for this right now. I don't know where Linda stands.
I want to make sure. Where I was headed with my thoughts is that we were looking for a bunch more lawn mowing, which I did not believe to be the $15 position, and that this was something different. That's what I...
No, my understanding...
If I'm wrong, I'm wrong.
My understanding was that it was for to do all the... Yeah, lawns, and also if Herb needed an extra help.
I think it was advertised as $15.
Yeah. And that was a bone of contention with the advisory committee because it shouldn't have been.
Time out.
Yep.
We advertised it as $15. We offered somebody at $15.
And time out for a moment. We advertised this position. We hired this position at $15 last year. Now, my confusion is that we also were talking about highway picking up additional mowing that over and above what they did last year. So that's where I come down on second position.
It was my impression that this person was going to do that.
There's no bandwidth. I mean, this person's doing... available hours. We hired this person to do a bunch of work at $15 last year.
I'm going to tell you that looking at this application, I personally know this individual.
Okay.
And he physically just graduated high school last year.
we're going to open up a huge can of worms if we...
So let's not do anything tonight. We've got a meeting next week. Let's talk about it.
All right. Put that on the agenda for next week. So we're skipping over six, passing over. Item number seven, we had a call to the superintendent's office. We have Maya's rate for medical insurance. It is an increase, but it doesn't violate the contractual obligations to the town or the school. So I'll entertain a motion to allow the chair to sign the benefit trust for Maya Health.
I'll make that motion.
Do we have a second?
Yes, we had a second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Today's the 5th?
Yes, today's the 5th.
Let that know, Kevin. There is no other, I believe there was one correspondence. MassDOT, the Chapter 90 money for 17 has been set at 167,197.
I saw that this week.
And it was released on April 1st, and Senator Gobey assured us that it was not an April Fool's joke.
Yeah, I saw that, yeah.
Any other?
Well, I've heard some talk that the employees, they're talking about, you know, how we were having our meetings on, you know, our employee meetings.
Yep.
And they are interested if we could do the round table. They're suggesting that. I don't
Clarence,
know if you...
Clarence had asked if we could go back to the monthly.
You want to go back to monthly? And they were talking about the informal one.
Sure.
The round table discussion on a different day.
See if we schedule something.
Can you... you said that Wednesdays... Because Wednesdays... See, Wednesdays, everybody is here. So better to have it on, I think, on a Wednesday. But you said Wednesdays aren't good for you.
For a round table?
Didn't you say, Linda, didn't you suggest one selectman?
Well, a round table really isn't a department head selectman meeting.
No. They wanted to have like more of an informal meeting. That's what they suggested.
They wanted to do it every week, to be honest with you.
That's probably too much.
No,
that's
to me it was a once a month discussion, wasn't it, Karen?
I'm not opposed to that.
Once a month, that's
better. Once a month. This is what I was told.
So do we want to just have a once a month informal, and that selectman, whoever sits in on it, doesn't have to be the same selectman every time.
Sure. Communication is key.
Yes, we need that. We need that communication.
So I'll let you set the first one up with them.
Okay.
Karen know when it is, and then right after that meeting, the next selectman's meeting, put it on as an agenda item, and the board will discuss your meeting.
Yeah. Okay.
And take two or three things that are important that we need to
move forward. All of them that are important.
No, but just let's get...
And we'll each take a turn attending.
But you're going to find that in that meeting, you could probably take care of half the things just with a couple phone calls right then and there that don't require a selectman's meeting.
Oh, sure,
meeting.
Yeah.
Yep.
All right.
Okay.
Very good.
All right.
Any other discussion?
No, I think that's it.
So just to follow up on my conversations at the State House today...
Okay.
Now, did you meet with both of them at the same time?
No,
separately.
Okay. Because I really wanted to go after the brownfield monies to see if anything, any follow-up. So on one side of the coin, Representative Berthium had talked to the DEP folks, and there is money in the brownfield that nobody's spending the money because the oil companies are actually fixing their own problems. And so the fund's there and money is there. And so I sent them back to go get the money. And that's where it came that... Did we own it? Did they own it? I said, clearly, they still own it. That's what we understand has to happen to be able to take the money, to use the money. But as soon as it is, in fact, a clean site, that then other actions could take place, which could include the town doing something. But at this point, you don't have to say anything about that. It's how do we get this cleaned up?
And he's going to follow up on
that. And he's following up on that. In the
and
case,
the good thing there is that he's neighbors with the Sixth with the Worcester, who has dealings with Charlton, with Exxon in there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's all, exactly. So then the second conversation came to the Indian work, the campground work. And I talked to Senator Gobey, because as we have talked about, we spent several thousand dollars in cleanup for this year. We'll have to do some transfers and whatnot to protect the transfer station and all that. We're looking at another $9,000 probably next year. What potentially could be something in the order of $9,000 just for the cleanup, nothing to do with the grant. I'm going to jump ahead. Friday, the director of archaeological studies at UMass is planned to be at the campground to view where we are and should we need to be doing something special in preparation for the summer. And so that's happening. I wanted to alert Senator Gobey of that fact, because it's important that we then potentially are able to go after additional monies after we establish what we have and what we need to be doing. So I wanted to make sure she was aware that this thing could kind of skyrocket or snowball to be able to do stuff and to get the place cleaned up. So anyway, there were debris found in the wetlands. One of the other reasons to bring the expert in is that there was additional debris found in the wetlands. We have a backhoe that's available to extract this material. The concern I have is disturbance to the site, now that it's warm and muddy and all that, and should we or shouldn't we? And so Kermit's working with the other CONCOM and the rest to highway to see who might be available on Friday morning, so we have a heart-to-heart as to what we may or may not want to do in the area of the wetland. The issue with taking the stuff out of the wetland is we'd have to store it because we have no way to dispose of it.
What is it?
It's metal debris. And I'm sure refrigerators, and I haven't seen it yet, but I'm thinking refrigerators and other. And so with that, let's get that stuff out of there. But we don't want to impact where we might be studying. And so it's kind of like, what's the right thing to do?
Because when we did walk, the two individuals said this is the area that we don't want to disturb.
And that this individual actually knows that information as well. So it'll be very helpful to, I think, have this preliminary discussion.
So when on Friday?
I didn't get a time. We all kind of picked the day that he was free. And then my last email to him was, will you let us know what the time is and we'll make ourselves available. So that was my day.
Beautiful.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Any other issues?
No, I don't think so.
I will entertain a motion to adjourn at 7:38.
I'll make that motion.
No, second.
And I have no discussion, so all in favor.
We're out of here.
Aye. Thank you, everybody.